Also, we can use this thermogravimetry to find out the influence of sample preparation. Suppose it depends on the material, right? So in this case, like if you want to evaluate the effect of drying, for an example, what happens when you dry sample? So this is like one day drying at 105 degrees Celsius, this is 30 minutes at 105 degrees Celsius, this is no drying. So these effects can be evaluated. Here you have an example of the sample preparation. So you see, what you see when you heat your sample, like for one day at 105, drastically reduce this peak. Clear? Like compared to uncrust. So it tells you that your drying process is affecting the amount of, in this case, CSH and eternite. So you have to pay close attention for how long are you drying. Even this 30 minutes of drying at 105 degrees Celsius will affect your initial peak, right? Also, you see one notice when you dry it for one day at 105, you see it could be because of the carbonation. You might have carbonated your sample. So you have additional carbonation. So that gives, tells you about the possible reason why you are seeing this carbonation. So basically, different sample preparation methods can be evaluated. This could be a tool where you can evaluate your sample preparation method. Here you say extended drying period of some hours or days leads to dehydration. Primarily, it affects eternite. Also, you will start losing water from CSH, but primarily the difference you see because of the dehydration of eternite. Okay. So here now it's the DTA and DTG curve of CSH. If you look at pure CSH, calcium silicate hydrate phase, right? You have a, here there is no DTG, TG, but it's a DTG. DTG is first order derivative of TG curve. So you see this primary region again because of the loss of water from CSH. Here they have used two different types of CSH. One in one C1.5SH2 corresponds to calcium to silica ratio of 1.5, okay, and CSH1.5 corresponds to calcium to silica ratio of 1, okay. You know that commonly what we have 1.6, 1.7 calcium to silica ratio in CSH present in potent cement paste, right, that is where we are. So in this study, they looked at the these two CSH, right, of different calcium to silicon ratio, right. So you see these regions in CSH with higher calcium to silicon ratio, like this case, you see some portlandite also because the calcium to silicon ratio is higher, right. Also at around 800, 900 degrees C, what do you see? You see this transformation. Your CSH transforms to crystalline form of wollastonite. Okay, CaSiO3. So there is a transformation happening. So that also you can capture here clearly. So this is the DTA curve now. So the top one was TGA, right? And here you have a, this plot is DTA. Okay, so you can basically you can see the difference, right? So the bottom one is DTA. You see changes. So you see the those changes at early temperatures like 100, 150 degrees C in DTA also, then you see primarily this transformation. So when you talk about the transformation, DTA is very good technique to capture that, okay. Now if you look at the TG, DTG curves for AFT phases, what do we see? AFT phases means, for in this case we are looking at eternite thomosite, right, there is the formula. So you can see clearly you have a lot of water, like in eternite you have a 32 moles of water. So you will lose this water, that is the point, right, you lose this water. So and you can also see the primary region where it you lose water is this, right, use in this range 100, 150 degrees Celsius, right. And you can also identify the difference between thomosite and eternite. So eternite peaks, this is because of eternite, it occurs at early temperature, and this is the later one is because of the thomosite, right. And here is given the weight loss, right, weight loss. Similarly, if you look at the AFM phases, again AFM phases, we are talking about monocarbonate, monosulfate, right, these are the phases, not this, yeah. Additionally, you have this Friedel salt is also there, you know, it is a chloride form. So, you are losing water at different temperatures, right. So, let us look at the left plot, right. Let us look at the monocarbonate, C4ACH11, this is the formula, 4 calcium oxide Al2O3 SO3 11H2 monocarbonate. It is formed when you have either limestone in your system or maybe because of carbonation, you may have formation of monocarbonate. So, you see how much water is lost in this region, first 5 moles H2O you lose, right, you have total 11 moles. So, you lose 5 mole H2 up to here, like roughly 16%. Then beyond this temperature 200 to maybe here 600, you lose further 6 moles rest, right. Then you have a loss of carbon dioxide, it, okay. Oh, should be, it should be C, yeah, CaCO3. It is not S, okay, this is carbonate, so it will be CO3, yeah. The monosulfate is, you have a 4CO Al2O3 SO3, okay. From this plot you can also see like monosulfate, now C4AsH12, right, you lose water. So, these are plotted together here, just so up to this point, right. The, this is the black one, okay, right, so black one, black curve, right, the green one was for monocarbonate, right. So, you can see how much, so 3 moles were lost up to here, this point, then I am looking at this, right, then you have further 3 moles, right. So, it can give you idea when you are losing the water, right, like from the phase, right. So, here we have a monocarbonate, monosulfate, and this is the Friedel salt. When you have a chloride, for an example, you see the formation of Friedel salt, right. And also the plotted is this Stratlingite phase here, just for comparison, right. And this is the DTG. When you take derivative of this, you will see appearance of these peaks, right. Because the slope is changing, you will see peaks, right. So, monocarbonate, monosulfate, Friedel salt, sometimes you have a couple of peaks, like multiple peaks, right. These are the things you have to pay attention to, like depends what kind of phase composition you have. So, here is a table you can use for the weight loss, right. This is the weight loss data of cement paste, cement phases, right. Starting gypsum, hemihydrate, anhydrite. Let us look at the portlandite. It gives you portlandite molecular weight is 74 molecular weight, right, add calcium, oxygen, hydrogen, you know, and then how much water will you lose, 18 grams. So, basically what is happening is, right, so this is 74, this is 18, right. Similarly, you can get it for like calcite for an example. So, you have information here, calcite, right, calcite. So, this is 100, calcium is 40, carbon is 12, O16, you can calculate the molecular weight, right, and this is 44. We will use this information to quantify the amount. So, here is the table you can look at. So, how do we quantify? The question comes, how do we quantify the Portland, that is very important, right, that can tell you about the progress of hydration, can tell you about the reactivity of fly ash. So, first of all, we can calculate the bond water also, right. the bond water is not free water. Bond, as name signifies, it is a bond water, structurally bound. So, when you, anyway, we are heating your sample. So, if the weight difference, this is the difference in the weight when you heat your sample from 105 degree Celsius to 1000 degree Celsius. The, why 105? We want to make sure there is no free water. So, you heat your sample to 105 degree Celsius, around 100 degree Celsius, so that you remove free water. Then you heat it up to 1000 degree Celsius. So, you can use that to get information on bond water. Now, how do you calculate the portlandite? So, calcium hydroxide can be calculated. This is your weight loss in your TG. So, you have done thermogravimetry, you know weight loss, right, in that regime, like 400 to wherever you see that peak. And then you can calculate this, because that weight loss is because of the loss of water, right. How did we calculate this? Calcium hydroxide is converting CaOH2O. So, this is 74, this is 18, and the weight loss you are seeing is because of the loss of water. So, if you know the loss of water, how do you calculate calcium hydroxide? So, calcium hydroxide can be calculated by measuring the weight loss from TG, that is because of loss of water, times 74 by 18 gives you measured calcium hydroxide. Similarly, you can use TG curve to calculate calcium carbonate amount. So, calcium carbonate is nothing but weight loss in your TG curve times 100 over 44. Again, very important. So, this you have done. Now, you have to rescale it. Lot of times people do not do rescaling. Rescaling is done because your solid fraction is changing during the hydration. Cement is hydrating, as we discussed in X-ray diffraction, right. Your solid fraction is changing with the time, right. Cement is reacting, you are forming more CSH, calcium hydroxide. So, the solid fraction is changing, that we know. So, you have to rescale it. So, you have to rescale means once you know the measured, then based on this formula, you can calculate the, you can normalize it by 100 gram of paste in this case, or you can do it per 100 gram of anhydrous. So, that you compare, if you have a time series data, if you want to compare your data at 3 days, 7 days, 28 days, then it will be useful to do this. Same thing what we discuss in X-ray diffraction. So, how do you quantify, right? So, there are few methods, like look at the tangential and stepwise method, right? So, you have this TG curve, right? TG curve. And when you plot DTG, when you take derivative, you know that when the slope is changing. So, up to here it is flat, then it is changing, right? And beyond this point it is again flat. So, you know this is the temperature range, first of all, right? Now, how do you calculate the area? Because the area under the DTG curve will give you the that loss, whatever loss in the, like in case of calcium hydroxide, it is because of water, right? We want to quantify how much water is lost. Then we will use that information to calculate the amount of calcium hydroxide, right? Because that is, it's what is happening again. This is happening, right? So what you are measuring is this. You have to measure this first. Once you know this, then you can calculate calcium hydroxide. So one way is, this is the stepwise. Stepwise means you just take this area whole, right? You plot DTG, right? And you, this whole area. Tangential is, you know, you plot the tangent here, you plot tangent here, so then you take this area, right. Stepwise means you directly measure the weight loss. So, you know that where the slope changes in this case, like here, right, from DTG. Same thing, beyond this the slope does not change, right. So, you know this is the weight loss curve, right. So, you can identify what is the weight loss. This is a stepwise, right, directly from here to here. That will give you the area of this. Because it is easy, people often use stepwise method. So, basically once you know what is the temperature range, you just measure the weight loss. So, you know, okay, from DTG you know it starts here, suppose let us say 400 and it stops here, let us say 450. Now, you go to your DTG, TG, you monitor, you check the weight, you see the difference, 400 to 450. So, that is the stepwise, because it is easy. Easier than tangential, but this is a way. So, if you are following a particular method, you have to be consistent. You cannot just follow methods according to samples, right. there will be some difference. In this case, you see stepwise gives you like roughly around 29 gram of portlandite, and the tangential method will give you 23 gram of portlandite. Okay. So, we know that now we can use, similarly you can do that for calcium carbonate also. So, plot DTG, you will know the temperature regimes, then calculate the area or just measure the weight mass loss in that region. Thermal analysis can be also used for asphalt binders, right. This is one example where use the TGA. So, you see here a lot of things, right. So, first TG curve is there. So, the blue one is TG curve, you see the continuous mass loss, right. By I think 700 degrees Celsius, almost zero, everything is lost, nothing is left, right. You see almost 100% weight loss. This is the TG. Now you have DTG. Now this is the DTG. DTG is change in slope. So you see this, right. This is the DTG. I am just removing it. Then this is the DTA. DTA is this. So basically idea is you can also monitor the changes, right. Something is happening, lot of reactions, is complicated, but idea is you can use this thermal analysis technique to understand the asphalt binder. So here you see three exothermic peaks, right. You see three exothermic peaks. Okay. Okay. So with that, this just for we conclude the module on thermal analysis. Again, references are here. As I said, most of it was taken from this book, Practical Guide to Microstructure Analysis of Cementitious Materials. Also, there are some other books which are very good if you are further interested to know more, and some web links which were used. So, that I will conclude this lecture.